this learning module, we're going to provide an orientation to the Teams app interface for the desktop, online, and mobile apps so that you can be familiar with how to navigate around the apps. We'll start with the desktop because that's the primary application you should typically work with, and then we'll go through the online version of Teams followed by the iOS and Android versions as well. So before we do that, though, a couple things to point out. Just to kind of the relationship between them all. So if you think about all the content that you'll have in Teams, and you'll learn about this during the course, you'll have conversations, you'll have links to files that are stored in SharePoint and other locations actually, and then we'll have links to other content. So all of that content in Teams is stored in the cloud in a secure data server infrastructure that is managed and monitored by Microsoft, monitored from a cybersecurity protection perspective, and then you use the various apps to access that content. So the Teams desktop app, which you install that when you first log into your Office 365 portal, you'll have an option to download it. Also, I would point out that if you invite an external user to be a part of one of your teams, they do not have to have an Office 365 subscription to participate in communicating with you via Teams. They will be able to download the application at no charge for the purpose of being able to communicate with you in your team. If they want to create their own Teams, then they would have to have an Office 365 subscription that includes the Teams app. And then the online app for Teams, which is very, very similar to the desktop app in terms of the features and functions. And the interface looks almost identical, if not identical, but that means that it's an online app, so therefore you access it through your browser, and therefore you can access your Teams from virtually any device as long as you have access to the internet to be able to log in. And then the mobile app, which is available for Android and iOS platforms, you download that from the Play Store or the Apple Store, the Apple App Store. They're free of charge to download them, but of course, in order to use them effectively, you really have to have an Office 365 account so you can, you know, set up your teams and work with your company's or your organization's Teams deployment. One other thing I would point out, the Teams desktop app, there's a version available, of course, for Windows, and there's a version available for the Mac, and there's also a version available for Linux. So they really have covered all the major hardware operating system platforms for the desktop app. Okay, so just want to lay that groundwork there as we go through and look at the different versions of the app. Second thing I'd like to just review before we go into actually looking at the application is what are the different types of Teams content. So first of all, you have what I'm calling private chats. So I'll use that terminology throughout the course. In a private chat, is a chat that is a conversation that is taking place in the chat portion of the Teams app. And I'll show this to you just in a little bit here. And so what that means, if it's a private chat, only the people who have specifically been invited to participate in that conversation will have access to it. Compared to that, we have the team post. They used to be called chats in Teams as well, but they changed the naming sometime in 2019 to call it team post. Those are also conversations, but as I alluded to a little bit earlier in the course, that anybody who's a member of the team has access to the post, whether or not they were actually part of the conversation. So that's a important distinction. And then you have files. So you can link to files. The primary method of linking to files from within the team is in the SharePoint application. Secondarily would be the OneDrive application, but you can also link to files that are stored, say, on your company server, or if you have another cloud-based storage service like Dropbox, Box, and some of those, you can link to files or connect to files in those alternative cloud storage solutions. And then you have, from within Teams, the fourth point of content would be links to other Office 365 apps. So you could have a link to a Power BI dashboard that you could view within Teams. You can have a link to a planner app, a plan, a project plan. And you could link to virtually any of the Office 365 applications that make sense to link to from within a particular team. And then the last category of content is what I'm calling external content links. So external to Office 365. So this could be a link to be able to access your company's financial or ERP system. It could be a link to access your website. It could be a link to access a customer's website. So there's really virtually no limit to what you can link to other than the security controls that you want to have in place. But from that, other than that perspective, you can link to all sorts of external digital resources. Okay, so with that, let's go in now and let's have a look at the desktop version of the Teams application. So I'm just going to kind of walk you around here what we have. So first of all, on the left side of the screen, we have the navigation panel to get to the different components of the Teams application. And I'll review each of those momentarily. At the top of the screen is where we have the search button. So you see it says search or type a command. And in the upper right-hand corner, we have access to our profile. So I can go in there and we'll see that we have options to set our notifications there and some other settings relative to working in the Teams application. Then, so right now I'm actually in the Teams button. That's why what you see on the display here is showing me my Teams and the channels within the Teams on this column here or this panel here. And then right now I'm in a team called Teams Demo, and I'm in what's called a channel. I'm in a general channel. And so these are the post conversations you can see here that have taken place in that particular channel within that team. And we'll be spending much more time in here. Along the top of this screen, you can see that I have, first of all, TD is basically the acronym for my Teams demo. That's the name of the team. You see I have other teams like clients, marketing, CPACs, curriculum, and so on. So then we have some of these other what we call tabs of things that different content we can get to. So as I just got done referring to on the previous PowerPoint slide, these are the posts. So think of post basically as conversations, but it could be other types of content when you get into a more advanced review of the capabilities. Then we have files. If I click on files, it's going to give me access to a list of files or file folders. This is really, from this perspective, not much different than you're accustomed to when working in the Windows File Explorer application. You can see I have folders and I have individual files, and I have a bunch of buttons that I can work with to manage and organize these files. We'll come back to that more during the course. Then these are other, just what I call custom tabs or custom links. So I have a link here that will launch the Teams demo notebook. This is a OneNote notebook. Demo plan is a link to a plan in the Planner app. Project budget is a link to an actual Excel file. So it becomes kind of like a shortcut, and so on and so forth. So we'll be spending time in there, but let's go back over here on the left-hand side, and I just want to give you kind of a high-level overview of what we have available to us in the application. So the activity bell, as I call it, or activity button, what this will show you is these are listings of posts that other people have made in Teams where you, in this case me, have been specifically tagged or at mentioned. So tagged and mentioned are terms you'll hear quite a bit when we are discussing Teams. So here's a case where Ann and I were having a conversation. In a conversation, actually I started the conversation, so whenever Ann replies to the conversation, it's going to give me an activity notification up here. And that's very helpful, because when you get to a point of using Teams for a while and you have lots of teams with lots of posts, then how do you keep track of what's new and where people are specifically trying to communicate with you? Well, that happens in this activity feed here. And when we'll spend some time in here in the course, because you can go back through this activity feed and filter it. So maybe if I want to look for all the posts that Ann made to me, I can just filter down and just see those. Or all the posts that Brian made to me, I can just see those as well. So that's the activity feed. Now, if somebody were to post in Teams and they mentioned me or tagged me, what'll happen is there'll be a red badge app on the activity bell. You see this red badge app on the chat? So we call that a badge app. That just means somebody's chatting with me right now, or somebody's posted a chat and I have not read it yet. It doesn't show up on the activity bell because it just, a chats are chat. You click on the chat button and you'll see exactly who's trying to chat with you. But in the activity bell up here, the reason when that lights up with a badge app, it's because somewhere in one of my teams, and I might have hundreds of teams, So that will allow me to know somebody's posted a message, they've tagged me. So then I click on the activity bell and that'll take me directly to wherever that post is. Okay, so that's the activity bell. Then we have the chat buttons. Let's go in and see what's going on here. So you can see that as soon as I go in there, the last chat at the top is Marcia. She works for our organization and we were having a conversation. And when I was outside of the chat app, so she had posted okay at the bottom here. And when she did that, it notified me in the chat button that there's a pending message for me. Now that I've come into the chat app, I can see the last message was the okay, and therefore the badge app goes away. So I'm basically, if you will, all current and up to date on my post in the chat application. So this is the chat application is where you're having your private conversations. So in this example here, this is a conversation between just Marcia and me. Because, and how do I know that? Because there's no other names there. If you look over on the left-hand side, you can see it's Marcia Sheehy. I had another conversation going with Ann Bucci. And then here's a conversation with Marcia and Rachel going on. Here's a conversation with Ann, Denise, Elise, and four others. So whoever you have in that conversation, they will have access to the conversation, but nobody else will. And we'll be spending time to go in here and learn all the nuances of how you initiate a chat session and all the tools that are available for you when you are, in fact, having a discussion or a conversation in the chat application. Okay, so that's chat. And then in the Teams, as we just saw a few minutes ago, we saw a preview of it. So in the Teams application, think of it as chat, as the chat application with a whole lot more capability. So in the Teams application, you create teams. So you see when with the issue with the coronavirus, we talked about creating a coronavirus preparedness webinar. And so we created a team for that. And so you can invite specific people to the team. When you create a team, you create channels if you want to. You'll always have a general channel. In this case, I also added a channel for brainstorming ideas, courseware development, information resources, marketing and communications, webinar scheduling and delivery. So why the channels? Well, the reason for having channels is because that allows you then to organize your conversations as well as your other content into, you know, more specific topic areas. That's really an important part of establishing your design for how you want to roll out the teams. So let me just go. We have a team here called Teams Demo that we use for just that. So it's just like all a bunch of fictitious or pretend postings, if you will. But you can see the Teams Demo is the name of the team. You always have a general channel, but if you choose to, then you create additional channels. So we created a customer service, events demo, and human resources. And you can also hide channels. So there's actually 9 additional channels in this team, and I've just chosen to hide them. So we'll kind of go through the details of how you manage that as well. I don't want to get too far in the weeds right now. I'm really just trying to give you the big picture orientation to the interface. And then down the lower left-hand corner is where you can either join a team or ask to be added to a team, or you can create a new team if you if your organization gives you that ability to do that. So when I click on any of these channels, let's go to the Teams Demo General channel. When I click on that, so what that does is that's going to show me all of the posts that have taken place in that channel from basically the beginning of time, if you want to think of it that way. So now in here, again, we have our posts, we have our files, so let's click on that. You see we got the files, and these other tabs that link us to specific content. So what happens inside the post is you carry on conversations, and you can see here, for example, let's go up here a little bit more. Okay, so here's an example where I posted back on April 2nd of 2019, I posted a message or a chat called budget. I labeled it with budget. And you'll see Rachel Bittner is like a hyperlink. You can see she's purple there. That indicates that I've tagged her. So therefore, when I posted this message, Rachel's badge app in the activity bell would light up with the number 1. And she would click on it, and that would take her right to this particular conversation. So I just, said, please update the estimate for rent expense. But notice I have a file name here, an Excel file name. So that's an example where you can link a file directly into a conversation. This file is actually stored in the SharePoint application. But I can go to SharePoint and find the file and open it up and work with it in Excel. But I have a shortcut right here, so I can just click on it and it'll open up a preview of the spreadsheet right there in the in Teams. This is just a demo file from Excel. And so at this point, I can either just look at the file here in kind of like a front end to Excel, if you will. If you go in the upper right hand corner here, you can see I have the option if I want to then open this up in the full version of Excel desktop or in the Excel online. And again, we'll come back to this in more detail. I'm just trying to give you at this stage an overview of the application. Okay, so that's the Teams button. Then we have the calendar button. So one of the features of Teams is it is an online meeting and call center application. So you can have voice calls through Teams. You can have online meetings where you can have a webcam or a video chat, if you want to think of it that way. And you can also share your screen. So just like if you're joining a live webinar where you have an instructor and all the participants log in and they see the instructor's screen, it's the same thing. You can do it in the Teams app here with the online meetings. And so you'll notice this is my calendar for this point in time. Every time now we make it standard operating procedure, whenever we add a meeting in our calendars, we make it a Teams meeting. And a Teams meeting is really not much different than just a typical Outlook a meeting, calendar invitation to a meeting. But what is different is if I go into, let's go into this meeting here, it'll open it up and you'll see the meeting information. I've invited Brian, Ann, and Rachel. And this is the body of the invitation. And it says join the Microsoft Teams meeting. And it has a call-in number. So that's all generated by the Teams application. So when I invite Brian, Ann, and Rachel to the meeting, when it's time to have the meeting, they just open it up either here in their version of Teams or in their Outlook calendar, and they just click on Join Microsoft Teams Meeting, and they connect into the meeting session. We have a course that's dedicated specifically to all the features and functionality of having online meetings and as well as calls in the Teams application. So speaking of calls, let's go down here to the Calls button. And what this allows me to do is I can actually initiate an internet-based phone call with any of these people here and others. I can go to any of my contacts. So if I were to click on this phone here, that would actually basically dial. Dial is not the right term to use, but it'll connect. It'll send a message to Marcia in her Teams app. Now, either she's in Teams on her desktop computer, or she may be in Teams on a browser, or she may be in Teams on a mobile device, whatever device she may be active in Teams at, it's going to actually ring for her, and she can then answer it, and we can start having a voice conversation. Okay, and if I click on the camera here, it'll be a video call. So my webcam will display for her on the other end, and she can choose to display her webcam for me. And you see we have ellipse here, so there's some other things. We could just have a chat conversation. So that's kind of the essence of it all. From within the speed dial, we could start a chat here, just like I could do a chat over in the chat app on the left side there. Or I can initiate a voice call, or I can initiate a video call. And then files. This is a little bit more obscure, at least at this stage of the course. But what is the files? This is showing me all the files that have been referred to in any of my Teams conversations or any of my chats. And we'll be learning about that throughout the course, how to incorporate the attachment of a file or a shortcut to a file in your conversations. But this is just giving me a place to just go and see all the files that I've included in conversations or others have included in conversations with me. So we'll be reviewing that as well. Then down at the bottom, you have this apps button. This kind of gets more advanced functionality, but let me go ahead and click on it. And what you'll see in here, there are just all sorts of apps. These are third-party created apps for the most part. Some are Microsoft, but they're apps that basically allow you to have connectivity between the Teams application and these other applications. So, for example, we use WebEx in our office for our large-scale meetings. So there's a tool, there's an app here that would allow me to be able to directly access and launch WebEx from within Teams. Same thing as Zoom. Some of you may have used Zoom in the past for online meetings. So there's an app for that. Dynamics 365 is Microsoft's online accounting financial application. So there's an app to link directly to that. Evernote, SurveyMonkey. I mean, the list goes on and on. And so as you get more familiar with the Teams application and you want to have more connectivity to external apps, that's where these come into play. And then last but not least, you have good old help button. So as you're exploring your way around Teams, click on the help button. There's all sorts of resources in there for you to basically try to get your question answered. So that's just an overview. Now remember, this is the desktop version of Teams. So let's go now into the online version of Teams. So now I'm in the browser version or the online version of Teams, and it looks pretty darn similar, right? Over here, everything is exactly the same, except for one button that they've added at the bottom here. It says download the desktop app. So the difference is the desktop app you launch from your desktop, the online app you have to go into a browser. That's the only real difference. In both cases, you really have to be online to work with Teams either way, even though the desktop app is stored locally and installed on your local device. To have any communication capability, you've got to be logged in to the internet. But other than that, that's really the only difference. You may find some things come up because in the early days of Teams, there were some limitations in the online version of Teams as compared to the desktop. Those have pretty much all been resolved now, so there's very little difference between the online and the desktop version of Teams. So we really don't need to go through all these because we just did that in the desktop and they look the same. So what I'd like to do next is show you the iPad version, the mobile version of Teams. So here's my iPad version of the Teams. I'm mirroring my iPad screen to my PCs to be able to record this demonstration here. So you see on my iPad, I use my Office 365 applications from the iPad from time to time. Not a lot, because I usually either use my laptop when I'm in a production mode, or I use my phone when I'm on the go. But once in a while, I'll use the iPad. So I've organized a folder in the iPad apps with all my Office 365 apps that I use. And you'll see when I open that up, there's a Teams button here at the bottom row. Tap on Teams. And this is going to take me into the Teams app. And you can see now that this is going to be a different, let me just kind of get to the same spot we were at on the desktop. Okay, so you can see that the interface is a little bit different, but it'd take you probably all of about 5 minutes to get, if you're familiar with the desktop or online version of Teams, it'll take you about 5 minutes to get familiar with how to interact with Teams on your iOS device. So you'll see we have the toolbar, which heretofore was on the left side of the screen on the laptop. Now it's displaying across the bottom. So we have our activity bell, we have our chat button. So I'll tap on activity. That looks virtually identical to the desktop. Tap on the chat screen. That looks virtually identical to the desktop. A little bit different on the left, right-hand side. We have conversation, files, and more. And then we have the Teams, as I just showed you there. So we can navigate up and down to all of our Teams. If I tap on the calendar, so this is a little bit different view here. In terms of what it's showing here on the calendar, that does in fact look different than what we're accustomed to on the desktop. And then this is showing me all the calls that I've had when I've initiated a call with various people there. I've got the history. And then I have my files tab over here. And once again, it's showing me a listing of all the files like we saw on the desktop application. So as you can see, it's, again, very similar in format. It just, once you get familiar with Teams, you'll be able to come in here and work with it very, very quickly. It's very intuitive. Now let's take a look. So this is the iOS version, whether you have an iPhone or an iPad. I'm actually displaying an iPad screen, so I'm going to have a little bit more to show left to right than you would on an iPhone. But let me show you now what it looks like on my Android phone. So here you can see I'm mirroring my Android phone to the screen here so we can record it. And you'll notice I have a Teams button in the lower left corner of the phone. So if I tap on that, it's going to show me, it's in the chat app right now. So you can see across the bottom, we have the activity button, and that's pretty similar to what we saw on the laptop. We have the chat button. So obviously it's responsive, as they call it, to the size of the device that I have on there, but I can open up that chat with Marcia. So pretty much the same interface there. You'll notice in the top right corner, from my phone, I can call, have a voice conversation and a web or video conversation with Marcia as well, just like we saw on the laptop. And then if I want to compose a new message, I just tap down at the bottom here where it says tap new message. So we have that. Then we go into Teams, and we can see all of the teams that I have access to there. So we have the management team, Teams demo, and so forth. By the way, while I'm looking at it here, one thing to point out, you see where courseware development and information resources are bold? What that means is I'm a member of that team, and somebody has made a post there. They didn't tag me specifically, but it's just informing that that there's some new content in there. So if I'm curious, I can go in and read it because, of course, I'm a member of that team. And I remember because I can see it displayed on my device. So we have our teams and our channels. And so if I go into general here, then it's going to take me into the post and the files, and more would take me to the other tabs that we had, the files that we're connected to. So it's a little bit different interface again, because of course we have a smaller display area, but once again, very, very intuitive once you get into it. So that gives you a good look now at the interface overall. Primarily, we're going to spend the rest of the course in the desktop application. We may jump into the mobile devices or the mobile apps from time to time, but pretty much we'll stay in the desktop application. And once you get comfortable with that, you'll be fine in terms of being able to work with the mobile devices.